Thank you very much. Thanks for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to talk to a room full of interesting people. This is not my screen that is supposed to show now, so I'll adjust my watch because I only have 15 minutes. And I think this, I have a problem here because I was invited to talk about global press freedom. And the problem with talking about press freedom on a global scale is that you get into the danger of comparing situations in countries like Germany and probably Great Britain and France to situations in countries like Uzbekistan and Iran and other places like that, or even Syria. And what I'm trying to do is I try to escape that problem by not taking a normative approach, but rather an analytical approach. And I'd like to map out to you what kinds of press freedom, what kinds of threats to press freedom there are, because I think all threats to press freedom are threats to press freedom. Now, if they are more severe or less severe, that's for us to decide afterwards. But for example, if we have a threat to press freedom in a country like Germany or the United States, that doesn't mean that we don't need to combat that. And if you feared that I brought you a slide presentation, I brought something worse. It's called a mind map. Okay, so I mind map something for you here, and we look at threats to press freedom. And what kind of threats to press freedom do we have? We have threats to press freedom from the state or from private interests, right? Now, if we look at the state, what kinds of threats do we have here? We have to distinguish between two different kinds of societies, even though that is a contested definition or distinction. We have open societies on the one hand, and we have states with repressive regimes on the other hand, authoritarian dictatorships, whatever you want to call them. Of course, this is a sliding scale in a sense that you have overlapping kinds of governance here. Now, if we look at open societies, what kinds of threats to press freedom do we have here? First of all, we have the problem of lack to access to information. Now that comes in two forms, and these are censorship or no freedom of information laws. Censorship is, of course, something that all of us are, well, we all know about this, although it comes in many, many different forms, and I'll come back to that a little later on. And we have the situation of no freedom to information or of information laws, or we could just simply say we have no access to information, again, on a different scale. Sometimes we have some rights to information, especially when it comes to governments. Here we are talking about governments right now, about the states. And in some cases, we have rather strong Freedom of Information Acts, and that means that basically there is a real big access to information on the government side. Okay, so now you could argue that censorship, if you have censorship in a state, or do you have, can you have censorship in an open society? Can you argue that there are open societies that have still have censorship? I think we can argue like that. We heard that example in the morning session. Germany, I'd consider a rather open society. At the same time, we censor information on the Holocaust, on Nazi activism and things like that. It was said that we have sort of a societal agreement on the fact that we do censor this, but we still censor. Okay, so what else do we have? We have a lack of protection against lawsuits by private entities. I just call that bad laws. What does that mean? I'll come back to that when I talk about private entities. Now, you have a problem if some private entity, a corporation, someone else is threatening you, you need to be protected by regulation, by laws, okay? For example, press freedom laws, press laws. If you don't have good laws, then you are badly protected. Now, that is certainly a threat to press freedom. We have criminal prosecution. Things happen, you know. Again, an example from Germany. There was a newsroom that was reporting, or a news magazine that was reporting on terrorism in Germany, and first of all, not only the journalists, but also the officers as well, were searched by the police, and computers were seized, and data was copied to the be monitored or analyzed by the police. Now this happens here as well. Thing is, after all, the Supreme Court, the Verfassungsgericht, decided that it was unlawful, but of course that was after the fact. Okay, so we have also surveillance and data retention. I think to an audience like you, I don't need to explain that we do have that in many open societies, that we have surveillance and data retention. And what are the outcomes of that? First of all, we have chilling effects. People will not communicate the way they would like to communicate. They fear that they are that their communication is monitored, and that they would be giving away some information, some pieces of information that they'd rather not give away. So that is also a threat to press freedom. And criminal prosecution, I had before, I don't need to explain this, as the outcome of surveillance and data retention. Now, when we look at states with repressive regimes, we have a similar situation in the sense that we have a lot of threats that basically just copy the threat, or not copy the threats, are the same kinds of threats that we have in open societies. Lack of access to information, same thing, you know. We have, on the one hand, censorship. We have, on a completely different scale, of course, and we have no freedom of information laws, or weak freedom of information laws. We have a lack of protection, we have criminal prosecution, we have surveillance and data retention, and again here with the outcome that, okay, I feared that it would happen, chilling effects. We have criminal prosecution, but we also have direct threats and violence by the government. Something that I did not put on the on my mind map up here, because I think this is something that rather rarely happens in open societies. It does, but not so often. Oh, okay, yeah, you see, I made a mistake here because I doubled this up, and this is, well, it's not really a mistake, because you can have that without surveillance and data retention, and you can have it as an outcome of surveillance and data retention. And you have a lack of protection against criminal structures as well, which brings us to the private interests. Now, private interests, I'd argue, come in two different forms. We have criminal structures on the one hand. We have legally operating entities like companies or other on the other hand. Now, if we look at criminal structures, what happens is that, again, you have direct threats and violence towards journalists, assisted or even encouraged by bad laws, the ones I was referring to before, right? So you could use as an example just journalists being beaten up by organized crime, beaten up by companies that don't want their misdoings exposed. And of course, that's a twofold danger, or one piece of it, or one aspect of it, makes it worse. You have the direct threats and violence, and if you don't live in a society that tries to protect you from those, to tries to shield you from those, you are in an even worse situation. Okay. Now let's turn as the last thing to the, or last factor to the legally operating entities. Now they threaten press freedom in two different aspects, in general aspects. First of all, suppression of information about the entity. They try to suppress information about what they are doing. Now, this is something that we are all aware of, that we are all that we all know about. What they try to do is they start lawsuits against publications and journalists, just to silence them. You know, in any society, be it an open society or a more repressive society, those lawsuits can really have existential outcomes. If you, for example, like a Japanese journalist whose case is presented on our website We Fight Censorship that Reporters Without Borders is running, take that case of this Japanese journalist who did an investigation and an expose of someone who deals with TEPCO, the company that runs the nuclear power plants that experienced some difficulties in Japan recently. He was slapped with a lawsuit claiming or asking for about 600,000 euros of damages. Now, this is certainly something that can silence people, even though no one broke his kneecaps. But that is, in any society, is something that can silence people. We have exertion of influence on publishers, and that again comes in two different forms, at least two different forms. You know, this is certainly not a complete picture. First of all, personal ties. You have business people, you have influential politicians, they have personal ties to publishers, and they can try to put pressure on publishers and publications. We also have economic pressure. Many publications are run on the on a business model that depends on advertisement. Basically, all publications except the ones that are either state-run anyway or are public broadcasters, for example. But we don't have a lot of others. Of course, now we have funding journalism and things like that, but that comes with other difficulties. And their economic pressure is always something that can be used to silence reporting and to suppress press freedom. And again, we do have direct threats and violence towards journalists, although, you know, here we come to a point where it is, at least in open societies, it is rather rare that these cases happen, or, well, probably just that we hear about those. But to have a legally run company hire someone to, for example, beat someone up or even kill them is not something that we hear often about in repressive regimes or in regimes with, let's say, a governance vacuum. We experience that more often. I think the former Soviet Union is a good example of what can happen there. And then we have the suppression of any kind of information by other publishers or platforms. And I put censorship behind there with a question mark, because that is something that is rather new, and we already heard about this in the morning session as well. And that is, of course, the example of companies like Apple, Facebook, Google, Amazon, Twitter, and so many more that have established a platform that is an important relay point of information. Now, here we have the situation that we are still struggling to come to terms with, still struggling. This is a rather new situation, but we have a problem of coming to terms with whether this actually constitutes censorship in the sense that, or in the, under the definition that only the state can be the censor. I don't really subscribe to that idea. I think also private entities can censor. It depends on the role they have. I think we do have that role now in many situations. But the other question, of course, is what kind of choice do you have? You don't have to be on Facebook, you don't have to use Google, you don't have to be on Twitter. But again, this is something that needs to be looked into a lot deeper, because these kinds of platforms develop a dynamic that is hard to escape. Certainly, you know, there are many people amongst us here in this room who would argue that in their respective countries, there's basically no way around a, let's say, platform like Facebook to communicate effectively with their fellow citizens. Now, what does that mean for a company like Facebook? We don't have answers yet. We are developing those answers. I mean, not just Reporters Without Borders, of course, but everyone starts asking these questions. We already heard the latest example in Germany of that talk show host whose stuff disappeared, whose post disappeared from Facebook. And afterwards, they said that, of course, that was not censorship, but only an error. Well, you can think about that whatever you like. The acknowledgement, at least, was there. And this is something that we are really interested in developing further. Now, you know, this is a rather complex situation that I mapped out for you here. But I thought it would be a good starting point for the discussion that we have right now, or for the interventions that we have right now. Because, as I said, all of these threats, be them as minor as they can be, need to be combated, and we need to fight these threats to press freedom. Now, of course, we have countries, we have societies where you can add up all these threats. You know, you have threats of violence by the state, by private companies. You have bad laws, you have censorship by platforms and by the governments. And of course, you have societies where rather few of those apply. But that's why I tried this approach and didn't argue that, or didn't try, which is something that we as Reporters Without Borders actually do, didn't try to give you a list of countries where press freedom is in danger or under pressure more than in other countries. Because I think all of us have a reason to look at press freedom in our respective countries and think about how we can defend this kind of press freedom. I just have one factoid for you as the end, and this is not, please don't understand this as anti-Americanism, but I just stumbled across this week and I found it really, well, what is it? Scary or depressing or it is the fact that the Obama administration has prosecuted more alleged leakers of national security information under the 1917 Espionage Act than all previous administrations combined. Okay, so this is certainly something that we can keep in mind for the discussion following now. Thank you very much.